So we've been looking at this book of Philippians under this series named Live for 7 weeks. This is week 8. And it's a letter of encouragement that Paul wrote to the Philippian church. Paul was in chains under arrest for his, just for proclaiming the gospel. They were up, the Pharisees and Roman people were upset at his ability to draw a crowd and what the message he was sharing. So he was arrested or put under arrest in chains, and he's writing from that context. He's chained. He's not allowed to be freely moving around at this point, but he writes a letter to the Philippian church who have supported him in ministry, in his ministry. And if chapter 1 told us that, we had right from the outset, Paul wanted to thank the Philippian church for what they had done. And he recognizes this ongoing support for the ministry of the gospel like no other church had done. And that's essentially what the book of Philippians is. It's this letter of support, or thanking them for their support and reminding the church, the Philippian church, of God's presence and his power and his ability to meet their needs regardless of anything that's going on. And Paul concludes this letter, which is where we're coming to today, in much the same way as he started, in a prayer or a letter of thankfulness for God's provision to help him and in the generosity of the people of the Philippian church. So today we're going to pick up from verse 10 of chapter 4. We finished at 9 last week, where Paul brings these thoughts back into the reason that he wrote the letter in the first place. And he's extremely grateful. It's very clear right through the book as you read that how grateful he is. And then it'll pick that up as we conclude that today. So if you've got your scriptures, Philippians 4 verse 10, and it'll be on the screen. If you're online with us, it'll be on the bottom of your screens at wherever you're watching. So Philippians 4:10, I'm reading today again from the New Living Translation. How I praise the Lord that you are concerned about me again. Paul writing, remember that. I know that you've always been concerned for me, but you didn't have the chance to help me. Not that I was ever in need, for I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. Even so, you have done well to share with me in my present difficulty. As you know, you Philippians were the only ones who gave me financial help when I first brought you the good news and then travelled on from Macedonia. No other church did this. Even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent help more than once. I don't say this because I want a gift from you. Rather, I want you to receive a reward for your kindness. And at the moment, I have all I need and more, and I'm generously supplied with the gifts that you sent me with Epaphroditus, and they are a sweet-smelling sacrifice that is acceptable and pleasing to God. And this same God who takes care of me will supply all of your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. Now all glory to God, our Father, forever and ever. Amen. Give my greetings to each of God's holy people, all who belong to Christ Jesus. The brothers who are with me send you their greetings, and all the rest of God's people send you greetings too, especially those in Caesar's household. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. So concludes the book of Philippians. And Paul brings this conclusion to us, or brings the conclusion to this letter, by introducing to us another key principle for all of us that will benefit all of us. It certainly benefited them, but it's a principle that we need to take care of or understand. And that is that it's the essence of contentment, this principle of contentment in all circumstances. There is a vast difference between wants and needs. And what Paul points out really quite clearly in what he has said in this part of the book today is our contentment is dependent upon how we prioritize those two things. If we place our priority on getting and having what we want in life, then it is highly likely that contentment is going to be a thing that is constantly just out of reach. If, on the other hand, we have our focus on the things that we need, the story is quite different. If it's about having what we want, the problem is that very few of us ever find ourselves in a position where there is not something that we want. And I would suggest that every one of us is in that position. There's always something that we would want and we would like, and it's nice to have. And you, people on in media, all sorts of medias, count on the fact that there are things that you want and make things look like that you need them, but that you want in order to sell their product. It's how our society functions, whether it's a new car, it's a new job, it's a new phone. Technology itself, I think, is one of those things that has an attraction like very few other things in our culture. But Paul says that he's found contentment, and he had none of those things, by the way. He has found it not by wanting more things, but being content with what he already has. And there lies the path to contentment for us. It's not in what we want. He was content with what he has right at this moment. He has everything that he needs. And for us, being able to discern between our wants and our needs is critical if we are ever going to be content in this world. And what goes along with Paul's contentment is that he's understanding and believing that God will not just be around and comfort him, but he will provide him of all his needs. And Jesus had already promised it. Paul was just reiterating what Jesus had said multiple times. One of those was in Matthew 6 when Jesus says, don't worry about these things, talking about all the clothes and food and all that sort of stuff. What we'll eat, what we'll drink, what we'll wear. These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, the wants. But your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything that you need. The path or the secret, if it is such a thing as a secret, to contentment is putting this kingdom of God before all things and being content with the things that we need rather than being seeking after the things that we want. Paul picked up on it again, not just in Philippians that we've just read, but he picks it up in 2 Corinthians 9 verse 8, and he says God will give or generously provide all that you need. He'll generously provide all that you need. Then you will always have everything that you need and plenty left over. Why does he give us plenty left over? So that we can share it with others as well. That's what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9:8. So the lesson for us in order to be content in this culture, in this world of discontent and this culture of more, have more, want more, desire more, pursue more, context is to not worry about anything but knowing full well that God will provide for us as we need and even above those things that we need so that we're able to give to those that others who may be in need as well. So when that happens, the stress of having to earn a living disappears. We have to do our part. We do need to exercise our gifts. We need to be faithfully doing what we've been called to do. But the stress of having to earn a living and worried about all this stuff disappears when we start to seek first the kingdom of God. And the problem for most of us is that we are in debt, not to our needs, but to the things that we wanted. And so our credit cards are overburdened, our bank accounts are overburdened with things that we want more so than the things that we actually need. And so what we do then is work harder, work longer, work multiple jobs, do stuff, everything that we can, cut corners on other things so that we can have the things that we want along with the things that we need anyway. Trying the expression, we try to keep up with the Joneses aspect has got so many of us into financial debt. And that haunts us for years and years and years until we are able to be released from that. The problem with that, even if you can afford it, is that when our priorities are placed on our wants, it will be those things that we pursue, and it will be distracting our thoughts from seeking first the kingdom of God, because that context then is I don't need anything and I don't need God, therefore I'm going to just provide for myself. That's the logical outcome for all of that. Don't hear me wrong. I'm not saying that God doesn't want us to have things. I'm not saying that at all. And I'm not even saying that God doesn't want us to have a lot of things. I do want to stress that he wants to bless us and he wants us to have the things that we need. But having those things that we need in abundance is not to build our own little castle. It is to share with others. That's what Paul says back, we read it just before. We'll have more than we need so that we can share it with others. He will provide for us. Hold on loosely to those things that are of this world so that we can hold on tightly to the things that are not of this world. We read it in Philippians chapter 4, verse 11 before, for I've learned how to be content with whatever I have, says Paul. I know how to live with almost nothing or with everything. And he did. You look at Paul's story, he came from having everything. Education, finances, authority, all those things down to nothing. I've learned what the secret of living in every situation, whether it's with a full stomach or with an empty stomach. How did he do that? With plenty or little, he says. How did he do that? Because he knows that his God, that our God, provides everything that we need. And then Paul makes this statement that you know very well, and you have probably quoted, most of you, I am confident, have even learned this scripture. In Philippians 4:13, it says, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. Most of us have heard that verse. And despite well-meaning use of that verse or those words, that verse, that text, does not teach us that a Christian is empowered to accomplish any task simply because we're saved. That is not saying that. It's not saying that I can jump off this because, you know, I can do everything through Christ who strengthens me. It's not saying that I can do stupid, crazy stuff because I know the Lord is with me and he's going to protect me. It's not saying that I don't have to worry about going to a doctor when I'm sick because I know God is going to protect me. He gives me everything I need. It's not saying that. He's not trying to say that we can do anything we like if we have enough faith. And yet that's how we often, or it is often interpreted. What he is saying in context is that we, as Christ followers, as Christians, can endure hardships and we can endure persecution because the strength of the Lord is upon us. God gives us the strength to be able to endure through all circumstances. That's the context of the whole passage. So when we talk about I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength, it's when persecution comes, when problems come, when hardships come, when difficulties come into my life, I know that I can get through these because Christ is the one who gives me the strength to get through them. That's the context of that verse. The whole letter has had this as its basis for what Paul has been talking about. And despite the fact that Paul is in chains, despite the fact that he has been often misinterpreted, misunderstood, despite the fact that even there, he mentioned back in earlier chapters that there were some so-called Christians, I think it was chapter 1, that were causing him pain by doing the things that they were doing and suffering, he was still able to rejoice. How? Because God enabled him. God gave him the strength to carry on so that he was able to do all things that God called him to do through the strength that God enabled him to have. That's the context that Paul is talking about. His value, Paul's value was not determined by what others thought about him or of him. His value was in doing what God had called him to do. His value of himself was his ability to follow through and on what God had called him to do, despite what others thought about him. There were many who did not like Paul. There are many who would have liked Paul dead sooner. But Paul's value or Paul's understanding of himself was not based on what others' opinions were. It was based on his value before God, and God had given him the strength to do everything that he needed to do. So he could honestly say that nothing would stop him doing what he was supposed to do because God was able to provide him everything, the strength that was needed to do the things that he needed to do. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Because if we were to flip that a little bit for us and we were to say, you know, I can do all things so long as everybody agrees with me. Or I can do all things if everything works out okay. Or I can do everything so long as I work a little bit hard or I can have all the things that I really want. Paul doesn't say that. He says that I can do all things through Christ, and he is the one who provides me with all of my needs. And then Paul adds, he says, your gifts, talking to the church at Philippi, he says your gifts are acceptable or appreciated, not acceptable, they're acceptable, but appreciated. Thank you for your gifts. They're very much appreciated, and they have helped not just me, but they have helped proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And while we might need to learn contentment in life, helping others have the things that they need is also part of the process of our contentment, being able to help others in need with the things that God has blessed us with. And it's not just financial. And we'll talk about that right now because that's the second point, the blessing of generosity, being generous in all circumstances. And Paul said very plainly that it was the Philippian church that had helped him financially, even when others hadn't, even when others had not even recognized perhaps then his need and the needs of his people. They were the only ones, he says, who had been faithful and generous in their giving. And Paul, more than once, Paul says they sent help. No other church did this in verse 15. Even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent help more than once. So this is a giving church that has been faithful in its giving to Paul's ministry over some consistency of time. And what Paul sees and what he is grateful for is that the Philippians have had this ongoing and sincere interest in his well-being and the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul knew about their support for him. Clearly, he knew that. And regardless of whether they had sent additional financial help sometime in the future, from the very beginning of the ministry in the Philippian church, they had kept the support or commitment to support of Paul's ministry and work, even when no one else had. That says a lot about their integrity and it says a lot about their character. And as Christ's followers, people in this congregation, in this church, that's something that we need to understand and grasp. And I've got to say, this is one of the most generous churches in so many areas, of not just financial, but in all areas. And I'm so grateful to be part of this family of people who give tirelessly over and above what you would normally be expected to do. You do that. So this is not a criticism. This is me now wanting to say thank you to the church who does this. What Paul is thanking the Philippian church, I see that in you. And I'm grateful for that. And as Christ followers, the attitude of generosity should never be far away from our lips or our hands or our feet or whatever else we need to use. And while Paul very clearly indicates that he's not asking for more help, he's saying, it's not that I have any more need. The generosity extended to him didn't go unnoticed, irrespective of what they did into the future. Rather, what Paul was saying, it was needing to help them make sure that they understood that what they were doing was worthwhile. It was helping him, making life a little bit easier, and he was content. Whether he had lots or little, that was irrespective, but this was helping. And not just that, Paul flips it a little bit when he says, it's not that it's just what I'm getting. He says, I'm wanting to say this to you because I want you to also recognize and receive a blessing because of your giving. That God might bless each one of us. That's what he says in verse 17. I don't say this because I want a gift from you. Rather, I want you to receive a reward for your kindness. That's what he's saying. And here's the principle that we need to take on board or to fully understand is when we are generous with our giving, whether it's financial or it's some other way that we're able to give, the blessing is always twofold. It's always what we give, but it's also the blessing of having given. What Paul tells the Ephesian church back in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 20, he says, I have been a constant example of how you can help those in need by working hard. You should remember the words of the Lord Jesus. It is more blessed to give than it is to receive. But at the same time, here's the catch if we're not careful and alert to this whole thing, is that our giving should not come from an attitude of getting a blessing. We shouldn't give so that we can get. That's the wrong attitude to have. And it's not what the Philippian church are doing, and it's not what Paul is saying that they're doing. But there is a tendency, if we're not careful, we can read into that, you know, you're going to get a blessing if you give. Okay, well, I want more blessings, so I'm just going to keep giving with that attitude. But rather than an attitude of give to get, our attitude should be that we should want to get so that we can give. We get to give. It's an exciting thing. It's a chance of blessing other people. If God has blessed me, I get to give some of that away. I get to bless someone else because of the blessing that has been poured out on me. It's a privilege to be generous. It might not always be a financial blessing, but when our heart is generous towards serving another brother or a sister, and we are obedient to what the Holy Spirit is leading us to do, He will always bless us. He will. And I read verse 8 of 2 Corinthians 9 before, but I want to put that in context for you now because I kind of took it a little out of context. Mind you, it still says the same thing, but I want you to understand what it says. It says, you must each decide in your own heart how much to give, verse 7, and don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. For God loves a person who gives cheerfully, and this is the verse I read, and God will give generously or generously provide all you need, then you will have everything you need. So this idea of how God will generously provide comes from a right attitude of our heart in the first place. And we need to understand that it's God's not just going to give generously to us because we want Him to. It comes from an attitude of our heart, right? Not giving reluctantly or in response to pressure of anybody. It comes because it's a desire of ours to serve our Heavenly Father. If our giving is a response to pressure, then it will likely end up that at some point that we will become resentful and bitter, and that resentment and bitterness will creep into every area of our life. If we are under pressure all the time, we'll be angry that we have to, or the church is always asking us to give money, or the pastor's always asking me to give money. Don't they realize that we're going through difficulties? They're the kinds of attitudes that come when we give because pressure is being applied. That's why you will never hear me, and I promise this, you'll never hear me telling anyone that you should give more. I won't say that. You might hear me give you the opportunity to give, and I may even encourage you as we have a project or mission or something that this is an opportunity to give, but I won't be hounding you to give more and more and more and more. I want everyone, that's one of the reasons we don't even pass an offering plate around, because I want everyone to feel that there is no pressure on in anyone to give, but you can give freely and generously as the Lord has provided for you. There in service here, there's a box here for you to put that in your own time, in your own way, and there's no names kept, there's no way of knowing who has given what, and no one is going to be frowning upon you. And I believe that when God is working in our hearts, we will be generous with what God has given us. That's just the outpouring of what the Holy Spirit does in us. He changes our thinking. We want to be a blessing to other people. And that's what happens with not just our finances, but in our serving and helping people in need and recognizing that there are people who need not just financial help, but physical help as well. The opportunity is always here for us to give, but I don't want anyone to feel compelled to do that. But our generous giving is not about just about us. And Paul's already spoken of the life being focused on the things above in Philippians 3. Think about the things above. And here in this chapter, Paul focuses on how finances can help him and help the heavenly realities, the mission of the gospel of Jesus Christ being preached to all people. And as a Christ follower or as Christian, our finances can be used to help others in need, can be used to help others come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, can support Christian leaders across our nation and beyond. They can result in blessings for other people, and as a result of that generous spirit, I know God will bless. And finances can be used to help those in need, because your Proverbs, this is Old Testament, says, if you help the poor, you are lending to the Lord, and He will repay you. Acts 2. What did the early Christians do? They sold their property and possessions and they shared the money with those in need. That was their response to generosity. So as a church, I want us to be generous. And as a board, as we've been meeting, looking at budgets and things for the coming year, one of the things that's been playing around in my head, we want to be generous. We don't want to be holding on to stuff just so that we can have things. Our role, our job, our reason for being here is to proclaim Christ to our nation, to our community, and be an example of Christ-likeness. So as a church, let's be generous with what God has given us so that others might be blessed in the process. And number three, the assurance of provision, and God will provide. He goes on in verse 18, Paul says, at the moment I have all I need and more. I am generously supplied with the gifts you sent me with Epaphroditus, and they are a sweet-smelling sacrifice that is acceptable and pleasing to God. This actually reflects back to the first point we mentioned this morning. Our contentment comes from being satisfied with what we already have, not what we want. And I'm confident that if the Philippian church or other churches for that matter had given more to Paul, he would have gratefully accepted them. There would have been a purpose and a use for them. He would not have said, no, I've got all I need. He would have used that because they were being used to proclaim the gospel. Whether he kept it for himself or he passed it on to others so that they could travel or helped other people in other means, I don't know. But if others had given it to him, I am absolutely confident Paul would have accepted that. But I'm also confident that if less had been given to Paul, if the Philippian church had not been so generous over a long period of time, he would not have complained. He would not have been urging people to give him more and more money. And the reason for that is because of what Paul said earlier. He says, I've learned how to be content with whatever I have. And that attitude can only come when we can honestly and openly say that we have the assurance that God will provide and believe that in faith. He will provide our need. He will. Whether we have much, whether we have little, whether others help out or whether they don't, we can be absolutely confident that as God's children, as Christ followers, God will provide everything we need. I read this earlier in Matthew 6:33. If we seek first the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, he will give us everything that we need. That's the principle that Paul is laying out for us in Philippians 4:10 through to the end of the chapter. It's not to say that it's not nice when others help out when we're in need. I don't think there's anyone that would be mad at someone for wanting to be generous. It's nice, and we really ought to be looking out for each other, for each other's needs, but sometimes it doesn't happen. Either because they don't know about my needs, our needs. Maybe, they're unable to help because of their situation. Maybe the Holy Spirit hasn't revealed to them the need that they need to have at this point in time. Or maybe it's because they're so busy with life that their busyness, they've got other things that are going on and they're not noticing. Whatever the reason, it does happen that people won't give help at times. But it's then, at those moments, that this chapter, Paul talks about our needs take over the process, that we trust in the Lord for our needs, even when no one else does. Not complain about it, not whine about others not helping, not whinging about what's going on in the world and all the wasted things that are happening. You might be right. It's more than likely you are right when that happens. But we need to go back to basics as a Christian. We really need to understand that God understands our needs first and foremost. He knows our needs even before we ask. Some would say, well, why do I have to ask if he already knows our needs? And I think one of the reasons that he does that, he wants us to ask him for those things, is because he wants us to realize our own needs. And that is firstly and primarily to put our faith in him and to humble ourselves before him and to pray and seek his face and ask him for the things that we need, not just to try and do things in our own strength. He wants us to submit to him. And he wants us to do this self-evaluation and say, you know what, this is a need or this is a want. I don't actually need this stuff. It's nice. It's helpful. But I can probably do without it. But if I should get it, I'm sure I would use it and glorify God with it. There's none of those things that are wrong in themselves. It's our attitude for pursuing those things. He will provide us everything. And many have heard this little illustration as I bring this to a close today. Many of you have heard this. I know that. And you know the ending to this. I also know that. But it's a reminder. And it illustrates this whole principle so well for us. And you might be able to use this at some point into the future. But there was a fellow who was stuck on a rooftop in a flood and he was praying to God for help. And soon a man in a rowboat came by, and he yelled out to the man, and the man in the boat says, "Jump in, I can save you." And the man called back to him, and he says, "Oh, it's okay. I'm praying to God, and He's going to save me." So the rowboat went on. Then a motorboat came by, and the fellow in the motorboat shouted. He said, "Jump in." He says, "I can save you." But the man on the roof, he says, "It's okay. I've been praying to God, and He's going to save me." So the motorboat went on. Then a helicopter came, and the pilot shouted down to him. He said, "Grab the rope, and I'll lift you up and save you." But the man on the roof said, "It's okay." He said, "I'm praying to God, and He's going to help me." So the helicopter flew off. Soon the waters rose, and the rooftop, and over the top of the rooftop, and the man drowned, and he went to heaven, and he finally got his chance to discuss this whole scenario with God, at which point he exclaimed, he says, "I had faith in you, God, to save me, but you didn't save me. You let me drown. I don't understand why." And to this God replied, "I sent you a rowboat, a motorboat, and a helicopter. What more did you want?" And I think some of the things is God provides our needs through people. Don't just sit there. We can't just sit there and say, "You know what? It's okay. Don't need to give me that. God's going to provide for me." Well, sometimes our help comes in the form of a doctor. Sometimes it comes in form of a neighbor. Sometimes it comes in the form of a good friend. Sometimes it just happens from someone you have no clue about, and there'll be a little parcel left on your door. It happens, and God will provide. Our responsibility is to recognize the Lord's help and give thanks to those who give. When we are able to place our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, we will never lack, because Christ is our provider. I know we will never lack. We'll have wants. And there'll be things that we really, really, really want. But from the earliest pages of Scripture, God has shown that the Lord is the one who will provide. To Moses, He revealed Himself as Jehovah Jireh, Hebrew for "God is the one who provides." And may God give each of us a spirit of generosity, so that the body of Christ and the community that we in which we live, and the nation in which we also live, is supported and is blessed. In fact, remember Joseph, the story of Joseph? Some of you will know the story of Joseph. It says that Potiphar's household was blessed because of Joseph. I would love to think that Yipoon is blessed because of the people of this church. And I think it's possible that God's blessing would pour out upon a city or a town because of the faithfulness of His people within that community. They might not know it. Pharaoh didn't know it. And not everything well went with Joseph. He ended up going to prison for something that he didn't do for many years. So just because we're generous and God is looking out for our needs doesn't mean that everything is going to go well, but God will provide everything that we need. Everything that we need. So we need to recognize that God is the one who provides for us. He's the one who provides the seed for the farmer and then the bread to eat. In the same way, He will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. 2 Corinthians 9:10. And I pray that God might give His assurance to you and me, that He will provide, even if it's not the way we're expecting it to happen. May God bless you. I do pray that this book of Philippians might resonate with your spirit, that you would take notice of the principles, the key ingredients we spoke about, the ingredients of humility, the need to have the mind of Christ, the need to make sure that division is not going to take root in our society or in our community of people, the church, but to constantly rejoice and give thanks, and the peace of God will come upon us as we serve Him, honor Him. And the path to contentment will be being satisfied with what God gives us, the way He provides for us. We do what we can without losing our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. So may God bless you this week as you serve Him, honor Him, bless each other. If you have needs and no one's noticing, you can ask, but at the same time, I would hope someone notices. So we've got to keep our eyes open, our ears to the ground, and pray and ask the Lord to show us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Let me pray. Father, I thank You for Your wisdom. I thank You for the insights that we glean from Your word. I thank You for this church. Father, I know that You are blessing us. I know that. And I see the generosity within this fellowship so often and regularly. People who serve week by week without complaining. People who prepare themselves for work even before they need to do it, so that they can be refreshed and ready. People who give out of their finances and sometimes even more than they can afford at times. People who pray for one another, who are on their knees more than they're on their feet because they know the need is great. I am so grateful. And I pray today, Father, that You might pour out Your blessing upon Your people. That this community that we live in might recognize the blessing of the Lord Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit upon it as we, the church here in Yeppoon, follow You, serve You, honor You, trust You. And I pray today too, Father, that there might be an opportunity for each of us this week to proclaim Christ's coming, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, give us those opportunities not to shy away from, not to be ashamed of the gospel, not to be worried about what to say, but that we would go with confidence knowing that You'll give us everything that we need to be able to do the work that You've called us to do. So Lord, may Your name be honored, whether it be in our thinking, in our acts, in our attitude, whatever it is, Father, let us bless Your name and keep us in check. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.